also cancer in the arm, and she's right now in America having treatment. So it's been a lot of things. I mean, a lot of having to learn and read and books and doctors, and I'm her only daughter, and she has my brother is 20, and so it's been just how valuable, and my mother's really been the only one there for me. So mm-hmm. It's like been very much like learning something new, which is fine. I'm happy to learn, and I know that my mother's, I'm very optimistic, and so is she, and they have incredible doctors in America.
Definitely.
And that's why I'm happy because I got her here, and she's getting the best help, and she's very happy and optimistic. So
when you so the reason why you teared up is because you're going through that with your mother. You say that I look like her mother, which I have uh-huh. to agree. I look like her mom, and we share the same birthday, and we've had a history.
Yeah.
So absolutely. It was just a whole bunch of emotions.
It was a whole bunch of things, and that just like put the lid on it for me.
Mm-hmm. Well, my prayers are with and for your mother,
thank
and I'm
you.
Sure my audience, everybody at home too.
Thank you so much.
I didn't know that. I'm so sorry. I didn't know that.
Hey, she's a fighter.
She's a fighter. Okay, now, one of the things, Naomi, that I was fearful of in the past was this reputation. Oh, Naomi, she's violent. She'll kick your ass, you know, like, don't mess with her. And so I never saw that happen, but you hear all these crazy stories.
Oh, I've had some crazy things happen to me in my life, absolutely. Some that I am not proud of, that if I could turn the clocks back, I would not have made them happen, which they'd never happened, but they happened. And as I said, I'm human and I make mistakes and I'm living with them, but I'm aware that they were wrong. Mm-hmm. I'm aware that no one should ever push you to the point of making you lose control. That is so important because everything you've ever, every self-respect is gone.
It's gone. So what do you do now?
I walk away. Yeah. I mean, it can be a boyfriend, it can be I have to walk away. I can't relapse on my anger.
Mm-hmm. Because what happens is you're Naomi Campbell, the millionaire, and they're like, hit me right here. You know, they'll try to take advantage of that.
But there's been situations where it has come up that, you know, because I have had that past, it's easy for people to say, oh, she did that to me, and it is a payout. And mm-hmm. that's the double-sided sword, basically, mm-hmm. that what happens with that.
Well, you know, do have a sense of humor about it.
I got it. I mean, yeah. I think I was sent a T-shirt last Fashion Week. Someone sent me a T-shirt saying, Naomi hit me. And on the back it said, I loved it. And they sent it to me. They said, well, will you wear it? And I was like, of course I'm going to wear it. What am I going to do? But
you know what's so funny? Miss J, you know,
Alexander?
Miss J Alexander actually wore that shirt.
How did he get one?
I don't
Where
know.
Did he get it
he
from?
Wore it on America's Next Top Model.
Did not.
So I was going to blur it out. Do you want me to still keep it in the show?
No,
or do you want
it
me
in
to
the show.
Okay, it's in the show.
Let me try to make it back.
It's in the show. I was going to blur it out. I was like, I did that? I didn't do that.
Thank you.
All right. No. Well, I know you have a sense of humor about this whole violent Naomi thing, and you actually did a very funny commercial spoofing yourself. So
you saw that?
I have it.
Oh, my God.
Check this out.
Okay, so today we're going to talk about our anger. We have a new member.
My name is Naomi.
Okay, Naomi, okay. Vocalize the anger of Naomi. Now sit down in your chair. Sit down, Naomi. Now sit your butt down.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, tell me about your products. I know you've got... like five perfumes or six perfumes?
Six perfumes.
In your name?
In my name.
Okay, so tell us about them.
And they've never really been in America. They've just been like in Europe and Asia and Middle East. And now the seventh one will be for United States.
Oh, really?
So,
hold them up. Let's see them. Tell us what they are.
This is Sunset. The first one ever was this one, Naomi Campbell. And this is I didn't actually want to take this kind of deal because I didn't want to put my name on a product because the promotion is heavy. Mm-hmm. And I was like, at first, can you put someone else's name? I'll just do it. Let's call it Sunflower or something. Like, we can't do that. And then we've got a couple myths.
What's the name? Just in case people want to buy one.
This is Mystery, Naomi Campbell. Naomi Campbell Sunset. That's
okay.
Just Naomi Campbell, the first one. Then we've got Naomi Campbell Paradise Passion.
And all of them have like body lotions and
she just don't know how to display it. Explain it all backwards.
I do not. Body lotions and
I know you're trying not to be very product placement heavy.
I know, I'm not good at this at all.
Yeah.
Body lotions.
Yeah. This is how you do it.
And a shower gel.
I know how to see it.
And
stuff.
I can use product placement for other people, but not for myself.
There you go.
Thank you.
So can you get them on the internet?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Naomi became a serious force to be reckoned with, from gracing the covers of the top magazines of the world to being multiple designers' muse. And Naomi didn't stop there. She's lent a hand to such philanthropic efforts as Nelson Mandela's Children Fund.
Great honor to have such an outstanding model. I really love you. Thank you.
And organized a fashion show for Hurricane Katrina relief.
With her energy and passion, she really does make a difference.
It is a beautiful day. Today I can rejoice because I have made peace with this woman right here. I have made peace with Naomi Campbell. Yeah. And one of the reasons why I wanted to do this show is because sisterhood is so important to me. I feel like women hate on each other. We're jealous. We fall into prey. We become marionette puppets of what people think women are supposed to be. And it has to stop.
I think that females fight.
There's competition everywhere.
There is a dark side to sisterhood, and it involves breaking, not making bonds. I call it the seven deadly sins of sisterhood. The first sin, betrayal.
She was sitting on top of him, and I just looked at them. It's hard for me to trust any girl, not because I lost my boyfriend, but because I lost my best friend.
The second sin, manipulation.
The whole time that the wife is having concerns that the husband's cheating, her friend is sitting there going, no, you're just overreacting. What are you talking about? He loves you. He's always talking about you. But she knows darn well she's sleeping with him.
Number three, judgment.
I look at everything when a girl walks in. I don't say she's pretty. I just pick what I don't like about her.
The fourth sin, envy.
That I had this very close relationship with her sister, it made her very envious of me. The envy just turned into bullying me.
Number five, gossip.
I confided her and told her about a guy that I was dealing with and how he performed in the bed, and it got around. I feel emotionally raped.
Number six, competition.
I literally hear my teammates say, I hope she misses a shot. I'd rather lose the game than for her to win it.
And when all of these sins get out of control, you have the last of our deadly sins of sisterhood, resentment.
That night, we both end up wearing the same exact dress. Towards the end of the night, she spills punch on my dress. I was just embarrassed to the point of tears.
Talking about these issues can turn resentment into resolution. That's why I'm calling all women to action.
If Naomi and I can sit here and after 14 years of going through a living hell,
yeah.
You know, I feel like if I can do it, you can do it. And this is my call to action for women to support each other. To I'm having a conversation with Naomi Campbell and finally addressing the feud that has been going on for over a decade. Do you remember that photo?
I remember
that photo because we didn't say one word to each other. It was after the thing that happened on the boat.
Right.
And it looks like we're just chilling and talking, but if you see there, you can, I feel the ice in that picture because I remember it like it was yesterday.
I don't remember.
You don't remember? There was no communication. I went from calling my mom, like, you know, saying, oh my gosh, she's so amazing, to calling her going, I don't know what happened.
Right.
We just did a photo. She didn't speak to me. Like,
I remember you telling me about the wigs. I don't remember anything.
You don't remember anything else.
But I remember that the ending of that trip was it was very cold.
We did a fashion show. I don't remember what it was. It might have been Jenny or something like that in Milan. And we were doing that fashion show backstage. And you came up to me right when I was about to walk out. And you said something. And it's so funny because it was so surreal at the time when you said it. I didn't think that you could actually say something like that.
What did I say?
You said, something like, you'll never be me, don't ever think that you'll be me, and something
like that. I said
that? Yes.
I can't think, that's something, I'm not that, I'm very much in the, yeah, I'm very much, I know the person that I am, and I'm not someone to go and give myself away and say that to anybody. I've never said that in my life. So, but if that's what you remember, I accept that, but it's not, it doesn't sound like me to people that would know me.
I'm not sure if you're understanding how much it was painful for me, and I think it was truly a painful time for you, but I don't want to speak for you, but, and I don't think you know this either, that experience between you and I was one of the most difficult times in my entire life. In my entire
life. See, for me,
life.
I can be really honest. I love modeling. I love this industry. It's given me a lot. It's shown me a lot. It's made me travel the world and meet amazing people. But with what I'm going through in my life in the last 5 or 6 years and what I've gone through of what I've come to know in making my mistakes, in maturing with my family, with myself, with my relationships, it's not life-threatening and it's not that deep. I didn't know myself at that age. I want to know what between 20 to 25 year old really does know themselves at that age. It's especially in such a whirlwind career. What I was envious of you was you had your mother with you. I never was able to have my mother with me. I always remembered you had your mother at all your shows and she was always there with you, and I thought that I wish that I could have my mother with me.
Why couldn't your mother be with you?
Because she just had a baby. And it wasn't possible. She had to raise my brother.
Let me tell you why my mother was with me. When I went to Paris, my mom wasn't with me. We couldn't afford it. I went at 17 years old, right out of high school.
Right.
So she actually had two jobs when I left and went to Paris.
Right.
We couldn't afford it. And there was a situation. It was a Versace fashion show. I was backstage getting my hair and makeup done. And this was about a year and a half into this feud thing that was going on. And then I think his name was Angelo, or Italian name. Can't remember his name.
Angelo,
was that his name?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Angelo called me, and he said, Tyra, I need to talk to you. And I said, okay. And he had a really weird look on his face. And I said, what is it? He says, I have to cancel you from the fashion show.
Right.
And I was like...
And you instantly thought that was because of me.
No, I didn't. Okay. And I said, why? I just did my fitting. I did everything. The show's about to start in 20 minutes. And he gave me a look and kind of did like that toward you. And I was like, okay.
Well, do you ever know Gianni Versace?
No.
Okay, so
anyone that knows him knows
I could never do that. But just so you know, you're not alone. Kate Moss was canceled after doing a fitting in a rehearsal.
Yeah. No. I've been canceled as a model a lot. I'm not blaming you.
That was the Gianni Versace way.
Yes. Like,
he was notorious for canceling at the last minute.
So that's not what I'm saying.
Nothing to do with me.
This is not my opinion. This is something that somebody did a
Someone
head nod.
Said, yeah. yeah.
So I picked up my backpack, walked out, and I was like, you know what? This is enough. This is enough, because I just couldn't take it anymore. I couldn't take it anymore. I went to a payphone.
You called her.
I called my mother and I said, Ma, I can't take it anymore. I dropped down to my knees. In that payphone, people were walking by, trying to help me in French, and they didn't know I was okay. It was just emotional.
Right.
I said, I can't take it anymore. And I said, if she wants it this badly, she can have this entire industry. I got accepted to 5 colleges. I'm coming home, and I'm going to school.
Right.
That's what I told my mom. My mom kind of calmed me down, and I said, well, the only way that I can do this is if you were by my side every single day.
But don't you think some of the things are like blown up a little bit? When I would read the press, they'd be like, but this didn't happen. We didn't have a fight on the runway. It really was blown up out of proportion.
No, most definitely. It was definitely blown up and perpetuated. But to me, there are certain things in the press that come from nothing, and then there are certain things that come from truth.
Absolutely.
And I do feel that...
But it came from somewhere.
It came from.
But I mean, the stuff that was written was exaggerated. Was, you know, people adding that little here and tidbits here and there.
That's always going to be.
That's always
going to
be that way.
Because negative press wouldn't have made me want to quit. If it was only negative press, you know, to be honest, Naomi, I'm fearful of you to this day. Not right now. I feel safe. I feel like it's just me and you. There's not a lot of hoopla.
Right.
But even a couple of seasons ago, even a couple of years ago when we did the Victoria's Secret fashion show, and I walk in the room and I see you, I'm like, I start shaking. My heart starts beating faster. I go back to the 17-year-old girl
that you used to be.
That I used to be when this powerful, strong icon woman that I looked up to was terrorizing me. There came a time in my career where I started to gain some weight. I started to get curvier. And I was told by my modeling agency that I needed to lose some weight. So I tried to lose some weight, and I was like, you know what? This isn't for me.
Right.
And I'm going to have my agency call Victoria's Secret, call Sports Illustrated, so that I can change my career and won't have to worry about being so thin to be a high fashion model. And to this day, that's the story that I tell the press as to why I left the fashion industry. I just didn't want to fit in those clothes anymore. I didn't want to have to be super healthy and eat only chicken and vegetables. But that's only 50% of it.
Mm-hmm.
The other half of that is I was tired of having to deal with you. I was tired of that pain. I was tired of the comparison. I was tired of constantly hearing that I got canceled from this job or this or that or this photographer was called or this magazine was called and was telling to not use me.
Mm-hmm.
So I made a conscious decision and I said, you know what? I'm tired. I'm so tired of this.
Do you have proof that photographers were called? Do you have any proof?
I have some close people with big names that I definitely will not tell their names today because they kick my butt.
Yeah.
But I have to say that I do believe a lot of it. I do believe a lot of it because there's a lot of these people have nothing to gain by saying that. They're not people that are gossip mongers.
I can understand you want to believe it. For me, it's not important to me.
Mm-hmm.
As I said, I'm in a part of my life, even then, where it's life means more to me than that. This is just a... The fashion world is a small pinnacle in the hemisphere of what really is going on.
But what happened at that time for me, Naomi, what happened for me at that time is a big part of who I am today. It was one of the lowest points in my life, but we all learn from the things that happen in our lives that are negative. And I think that's what made me start T-Zone. I think that that rivalry has made me start America's Next Top Model because I said, I will never be what that represented.
Right.
And I went 100% against that and said, And I don't think it was a conscious thing. It's something I look back on now and
you
go, maybe that's why. Maybe that's why I started my T-Zone. Maybe that's why I started America's Next Top Model. Maybe that's why I have this talk show.
Mm-hmm.
So to teach that no matter what people say or do or try to look at women as marionette puppets that they want to create this bickering and this battle and this fighting, that we have to be bigger than that.
Absolutely.
We have to be more responsible than that. And so experiencing that and being, I think, a victim, both of us, victims of that.
But there's so many more things out there to be victims of. But I don't actually want to ever say that I'm a victim. I'm someone passing through my life that's going to hit the lows, it's going to hit the highs, it's going to hit the successes.
Yes, but in being a victim, you don't have to let that conquer you. It's being victimized and then being empowered.
It's not going to conquer me. It's like when I wanted to go in recovery, it's the best thing I ever did in going to recovery.
Mm-hmm.
I learned so much about myself for years. I can remember things from when I was 3 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And it just very vividly. And I was like, wow. It's
like what from when you were three?
Things that just affected me now, that I and at that time when it came into my mind.
What do you mean by that?
When I was a child, something happened to me, and my whole family was like, no, she's crazy.
Sexual abuse?
And it wasn't really sexual abuse. It could have been, but I was very much of a child that I came in and I spoke up very much for myself. I was like, so I screamed out, like, go away, and that by being loud.
So it was a possibility of sexual abuse, but
she did stop
it. Because
I was loud, I got it. It didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in the desert, and I just was like, you know what? It's something that I want people to know that rehabilitation should be taught in schools, because it's something, once you know the tools, you know when you're not happy, when to stop and stagger, take time out, when to say, okay, I'm trying to please everybody, and this is not working for me, and not be afraid to say, I don't want to do this anymore, because there's a lot of you get so secure in one thing and you say, okay, if it's over, what do I do?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not afraid of anything anymore. I'm willing to just face things.
At one time you were afraid?
Yeah.
What were you afraid of?
Definitely. I was afraid, when I realized I had to go to rehab, and I was like, okay,
I need to take off a month of work. Oh my God, I can't take off a month of work because I'm gonna miss this, and I'm gonna miss this because I'm gonna perfume. I'm like,
what did you think would happen at that time? The fear if you did take off that month. What did you think?
It wasn't a fear of not. It wasn't a fear that I was gonna. Actually, I don't know. I wouldn't know.
You think your stock would have gone down if you would have taken off that?
It's not about stock. It's about emotionally drained, spiritually drained. I would have been no good to myself. Mm-hmm. Not healthy in mind, not healthy in spirit. Mm-hmm. And not good to anybody.
Do you feel like you've had to put up a lot of defense in this industry to survive in an insane world?
I put up defense because I don't want to show my vulnerability. I put
what
up defense. Like, it's like, I think people who really know me, Tyra, can, my really close friends, you know, I have a big heart, I'm very generous, when I'm very loyal. Mm-hmm. And I'm happier now than I was in my 20s. I'm mm-hmm. much happier now.
Why is that?
Because the way I was living my life then was too much. Mm-hmm. I was like trying to make everybody else happy, but I wasn't happy.
Mm-hmm. You weren't happy.
No.
So what did you do by not being happy? Because to me,
well, I tried to self-medicate and I numbed, trying to numb my pain. Mm-hmm. And in, you know, 97 was a really difficult year for me. I lost 6 friends in very strange circumstance, one of them being Gianni Versace. And I think that was a year that was a year when I started to go down because I was really not knowing how to cope with grief. I didn't know.
Mm-hmm. You didn't know. And how did you deal with it? You dealt with it by taking?
I self-medicated myself. Mm-hmm. I drank. I went out. I just was like, no, I'm fine. Don't mm-hmm. worry about me. I'm fine. But each time another drama or another grief or death came into my life, it wasn't enough time to catch up from the last grief. So it was just one big melting mm-hmm. ball. It just went rolled down.
So when I met you, when I was 17 years old, say until I was a fashion model till about 25 years old, mm-hmm. were you self-medicating yourself at all
no,
during that time?
No, I didn't take my first drug until I was 24 years old.
24, mm-hmm. really. Let's go back to Paris. I'm 17 years old, mm-hmm. and all these people are saying these negative things. Oh, look out, Naomi. Here comes the new one. Uh-oh, you better get back. Oh, look, she's trying to look just like you. You better get that. How would you handle
that now?
If you could do it all over again, how would you handle?
I think I wouldn't. I just simply, really simply wouldn't have bought into it. I would have just not bought into it, and then it would never have escalated. Mm-hmm. I think when you buy into things, people are malicious. People like negative, like you said and sat here and gone over many times. And I think that only you are the one, if you pay attention, that makes it escalate. Mm-hmm. But I didn't realize at that time that's what would happen. I was like listening because I was not a little older than you, but I was also not in my country. I was also used to, oh, you're this, you're that. I think, you know, it really is buying into it. Mm-hmm. If I knew then not to buy into it like I know now, it would never have escalated.
And we would never be sitting on this couch right now.
But I am happy to be sitting on this mm-hmm. couch right now. So, you know, I'm happy to, I don't know how many years you say, 14 years later, mm-hmm. to be sitting here and to wanting to have done this show. And I didn't really tell anybody that I was coming to this show because I didn't want to have to hear what they thought. Mm-hmm. So I thought, I'd come. They don't know I had to go to LA. They don't know what I had to come there for. And they will now. But no, I'm happy that I came.
Mm-hmm. I'm happy that you came too.
I really am.
I really am too. Are we ready for the audience?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I couldn't have done this with the audience here. So when we come back, we're going to have everybody here, the entire audience, and Naomi and I together for the first time in front of an audience in, I don't know how long, a long time.
You said 14 years.
14 years.
She's 14 years.
Yeah, 14 years. All right, we'll be right back. Well, before the break, I have to say that one of my wishes, one of the biggest wishes that I've ever had, has come true. I had a conversation with Naomi Campbell, a long, in-depth conversation, and I got a lot of answers, and it has started my healing from all of the devastating rumors and gossip and rivalry and pain that I have experienced. I've started to heal, and I think Naomi has too. And now the audience is here, right? So now I want all of you and all of you to again welcome Miss Naomi Campbell.
boyfriend.
Who would have ever thought Tyra and Naomi would be on the stage sitting here together? Who would have ever thought that?
I have something I have to say.
What's that?
I have something I have to say before we start. However I've affected you, or have you felt that I've affected you, I take my responsibility. I just want to say I'm very proud of you for being a powerful black woman sitting here and doing what you're doing. And please continue, okay?
Thank you so much. Naomi, thank you so much for saying that, because I have to admit, before the break, it was a beginning of a healing.
I know.
But I still felt like...
Closure.
Yeah. Absolutely. I still felt like I don't think she's owning up to anything, or, you know, and by you just saying that one thing, you have no idea what my heart is doing now. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Guys, sorry. I'm tearing up right now. You're tearing up right
Thank
now.
You.
And one of the things that I didn't know and that you didn't know is that your mom and me have the same exact birthday. Why do you think that made you tear up when you found that out?
I'm going through a lot with my mother. My mother has breast cancer and also cancer in the arm.
Where do I start? Well, I was born and raised in Sudan, in the south of Sudan, and in a small town called Wau. And then by the age of 14, I moved to England at age 19. I was, quote unquote, one Sunday afternoon, I was in a park, and that's where I was discovered. I was approached and asked if I wanted to be a model. First, I was just happy and glad to be able to get the opportunity to be creative as a model, to work with different teams. And I would say that what's been really wonderful is to give me that evolving process where I'm not just doing the same shoot, I look always the same, but to give me a creative freedom where I could really have fun and do something different. I think that's really fantastic. You know, shooting with Steven Meisel for Italian Vogue, all that 8 or 10 pages and all Versace dresses and just having fun, and it was just dancing and music and everyone really worked together very well. No fun, my babe. No fun. I love painting. It's my hobby. I've always painted all my life. It fulfills my soul. It's one of the things that I do. So I got inspired and I came up with this painting. And then that's when I also started to design my small line, WEG 1933. These were the first paintings I started to paint when I moved to New York. These are called Lifeline, and I did the exaggerated version on the other side, as you could see, in different colors, which I thought were quite interesting.
My personal style, I love to mix and match. I love vintage as well, which I find really interesting. Whether it's like when I'm just relaxed, I like to wear perhaps a jeans with a nice top, and you could always throw in some shoes, or like a lovely dress like for the evening, such as this one. It's quite nice. You could wear it with sandals, it gives it a different feeling, or you could wear it with boots, which is kind of cool. I like working with different designs because it's diverse, you know, like for example, a Gautier is completely different than, you know, a Fendi, and a Fendi is completely different than a Ralph Lauren, and then you have like a Zac Posen, and then you have like a Diane von Furstenberg, which I adore, especially being, you know, a woman, and just her dresses, how she makes women look, different ages. I find that really chic and beautiful. and she's kind of like an artist as well. I like the diversity of the different designers.
I am really, really loving these prints. I think I'm going to try it on, actually.
She's gone to break your heart in two. It's true.
I've been really lucky, you know, the fact that to work with like such talented designers, such as, I remembered, you know, it took forever for me to, I was doing all these different, you know, all the most amazing shows, but I couldn't understand why I couldn't do Dior. And I was like, can I at least go in there and try it on? And then if it doesn't look right, then I understand. But at least I had a chance to go in there, because I think, you know, John Galliano is just amazing, and what he did for Dior, just with his, you know, design, it's just, it's really amazing, and he does it over and over and over. So when I went, I mean, of course I was like nervous, you know, but he was just, he didn't even say much, and he was like, let me put this look on her. And I walked out of there before I could even, you know, get in the train. This was like, obviously, you know, like 10 years ago or so. I get a phone call from my agent. She was just like, you're booked. And I'm like, yay! I'm like, it was so beautiful. And it was that collection where it was, I think it was the 30s, where it's like lace and baby blue. And then he had all these, you know, little hats and, you know, and the jewelry. I was just like, oh, that's so gorgeous. So that was really nice. What can I say? Thank you so much, Italian Vogue, for coming to Fort Greene, where I reside, Brooklyn, New York. And it's been fantastic working with you and talking to you right now. So I appreciate it. I'm sending lots of love from Fort Greene. Back to you. And this is how I made it. In terms of, you want to talk about fashion, of course fashion is fashion, not just in the modern world, quote unquote, how I got discovered in a park to be a model, but as girls, I come from one of five, we always talk about clothes and shoes and makeup, but it's in a different way. It's in Southern Sudan, there's no, you know, magazines at the time and so forth. But I would say, you know, in my teens, at 19, that's when I start to really realize what fashion was. And when I got discovered in Crystal Palace, would you like to be a model? And I was like, me? Are you serious? And she was like, yes, absolutely. And that's when I realized what fashion was, to be honest. But still, I had to educate myself a bit more. Beauty is deeper than just what you look at in a picture.
you could fancy what you like, but as a woman, my mother always raised us to believe in ourselves. I am very grateful the fact that my mother brought me up that way. So I think beauty is not just about, you know, what we put on our head or on our faces or what we wear. It's deeper than that, and if we can celebrate that and celebrate the women, not just, you know, the superficiality per se, because it's a lot that goes on, I think it would be really gorgeous to be able to just be a woman and express myself 100%. I think that's incredible, and people to celebrate that. I think it's beautiful beyond words. In England, of course, I got called, what, Midnight Black? What else? Alegwek, it's not that gorgeous. I never said I'm that beautiful, but every woman is beautiful. They never really accepted, you know, especially, I mean, it's not like I can hide that I'm black. I mean, aside from the jokes, I think that the perception of models from in the terms of, you know, being black, what they perceived it as high fashion and so forth, they didn't know what to do with me. I have short hair. It doesn't make me an attractive than a woman or my sisters that have more longer hair, so, and are a bit lighter. I think that's where it becomes a bit miscommunication or a bit bizarre, that we don't, you know, wanna define what is beautiful. But I think as black women, we should celebrate the fact that we can come in different colors, you know, in different hair, but the hair doesn't define who we are. The woman we are defines who we are. Sometimes you have to follow your dream. And for me, I felt I had to, if I'm gonna just be a model, it's not just, you know, to just do a few pages in magazines. I thought it would be lovely to show that you could be as gorgeous as you are, even though it's not what people, the standard of beauty, people show it in the magazines, but who defines beauty, no? You make your destiny. And for me, I had to be a high fashion for people to understand I can make it this far. You can't really, you know, accommodate everybody, but you can love what you do. Like my father said, if you love what you do, focus all the way, and there's no messing around, no time to lose. And I truly believe in that, so that's why I kept on.
Different people from different backgrounds, different cultures, we get involved in this business, the more fun it is. I started in London, I was discovered on a street fair, and I didn't take it serious at first. I was like, you know, you gotta be joking, and it was real. And then a year later, they took a Polaroid, and one of the bookers in New York was interested in me, just come and represent me and see how it goes.
A native of Sudan, Alek Wek's world was about to change.
Modeling doesn't really exist in Africa. took a while before I got my papers together, but I came in the summer of 96 and I went to like 17 appointments a day for like a month. And after like 2 months, Francois shot me and Steven for Italian Vogue, and the rest is history.
More than just a pretty face, Elek is also an artist. She turned her passion for drawing into an accessory business which honors her father.
It started off because I always painted since I was young. Weck, of course, is my second name, Elek Weck Etienne. But 1933 is when my dad was born, and he passed away when I was 12. It's a celebration to me. So that's why it's just 1933. His dream was for me and my 9 brothers and sisters to be able to go to school, get an education, and have an opportunity in life.
A decade later, Elek is still a fixture on the international fashion circuit. We found Elek front row in Milan, where she was pitching in as a guest editor for Amica magazine.
It's very nice to be invited as a guest editor with, you know, Amica. And I was like, that would be quite interesting, actually. Why not? And I've never really been on the other side since being modeling for 15 years. As time go by, I like to model in moderation now. Once in a while, do an appearance as well, get on the runway.
She may have scaled back her catwalk appearances, but Elek has plenty else to keep her busy. She's still working on her accessories line, and she's the cover girl for Aid in her native Sudan.
The humanitarian work, which is something that's very dear to my heart. I've been very active with UNHCR, United Nations High Commission for Refugees, and with definitely taking a trip back to southern Sudan, which just celebrated their independence last year. And if I can be a little bit a part of helping to rebuild the community and so forth, that's what really is important. We do have a very strong voice in fashion, and I think we could really use that for the best.
As the first black supermodel, she revolutionized an industry that hesitated to acknowledge those who were different. Despite her struggles with shyness and looks she described as nothing special, she took New York and then the world by storm. From there, she built a cosmetics empire, stretched her acting legs in numerous films, and married pop superstar David Bowie. Hi, I'm Ernie Manous. Coming up on this episode of Interviews, our conversation with international supermodel Iman. Career, how do you judge success?
By what you inspire other people to do.
Really?
Yeah, I think that's what really success is. It's not what you achieve or what you gain, it's what you really inspire other people to do.
Did you always see it that way? In the beginning of your career, would you have answered that question the same way?
No. It would have all been about me. Yeah, what's in it for me? It would have been that, yeah.
What made that change then for you?
I think age, you accumulate some kind of a wisdom. You see how you affect other people's lives in small ways that become big ways.
Yeah.
Self-esteem is a big issue, as little as it is. And as everybody thinks that, especially pretty people or pretty girls have it. And kids, you think they are born with exuberance and innocence, but their self-esteem can be taken away so easily. That simple thing that I do in my career as a model and then especially as a CEO of Iman Cosmetics has been really huge for me. Mm-hmm. It galvanized the whole generation of young girls to think of themselves differently. So to me that is, you know, that is an inspiration to me to see people, young girls changing right in front of my eyes as they grow up and saying, yeah, yeah, I am too beautiful, yeah.
Did you ever feel you were on the evil side of that? That when you were being photographed in the image and all that, that was projecting that kind of surface beauty is so important. And did you ever feel like, wait, I've got to fight against that image?
I never felt that I had to really fight against that. Because simply when I came to America in 1975, I came from... I was already a fully formed young adult. I was 18 years old, but I've already been a daughter of a diplomat. My mother was a doctor. I was in boarding schools. I had a privileged life. And then all of a sudden, in a wink of an eye, everything was taken away. We had to flee in the middle of the night, mm-hmm. On a van, cross a border, with nothing but the clothes on our back. And so I've seen it from the have and have nots.
How old were you at that
time? I was 15.
Okay.
And coming to Kenya and being at the mercy of the government and the government giving us refuge and giving us children scholarships for education, but to a limited amount of years, so we had to fetch for ourselves. And to having seen that and then all of a sudden a turnaround and being so what they call discovered and becoming a model and then all of a sudden having lots of money.
Right.
At an early age, also at the age of 18, 19, I have quite a good perspective of what money is about and what fame is about and how fleeting it is.
Can you still remember the feelings that you had when you were 15? Can you still remember that fleeing?
When I was 15, I had absolutely no self-esteem. I was a very studious, nerdy little girl and nobody has ever said I was beautiful, so beauty was not something that was even spoken, at least not around me. And people don't believe me when I say this because people just, obviously, they look at you as you are now and then they think that that's how you were always. And most of the people, most of the women I know that are beautiful are the most complicated and not self-assured of themselves. Obviously, there are those ones who are too assured of themselves
right.
because of their beauty. So it comes in two ways. But when I was 15, I was so introverted, I had no idea what was going to be my life about.
Yeah. What about when you see these small children that are put in these circuit pageants and all of that stuff, or the child models?
Yeah.
How do you feel about that?
It's so foreign to me because I've never seen it in any other place but in America.
Really?
You know, I've never seen any kind of beauty pageants for children in any other country but in America. So it's so foreign to me.
Yeah.
And when you see it, that you cringe first because it's so, I won't even use the word evil, because there is this glee in the eyes of the children, there is the glee in the eyes of the parents, and so you can see that there is the intention is not bad, but there's nobody have thought through this,
yeah,
and what it could do to the kids, and to those parents who are trapped in their own ways by living vicariously through their children. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit bizarre and surreal and sad in a way.
Yeah. And I know that you were married, your first marriage, very early age.
Yes.
If you hadn't been in that marriage, would you have been discovered? Would you have taken the things that came that way? Do you ever look at it that way? And for people who don't understand, you were not discovered in the jungles. You were not discovered as a sheep herder. You were actually going to university. You were on the streets.
Speaking five languages.
Yeah.
I always said I was not discovered because I was not lost.
You know? But boy, there were plenty.
Found me. We found her. No, we are. You didn't.
There
find
were plenty of stories, though, about who you were, where
I know,
you came from.
And to me, at times they were insulting, and at times I was a co-conspirator, mm-hmm, because when I really knew about it, and I told the press that that's not true, and they still wrote that, then I am a co-conspirator in the whole fabrication of my discovery and who I was. And but it's amazing that they actually needed a story. Yeah. You know, nowadays all you have to say is that, oh, I was discovered. You
right.
know, but to make that kind of a fabrication that is so beyond imagination, and you think, why did anybody need it in 1975? You know,
right.
We're not talking about 1945 or 1800s.
But boy, it certainly gave you a story. It certainly shot you to the
absolutely.
Top of the charts.
Absolutely,
yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm to think of it in hindsight now, as much as I was upset with them at that time, to me, it's that is the auspices of how I started.
Yeah. But to go back a little bit, when you're talking about you were married,
yes,
and it wasn't a perfect marriage,
yes,
from where you were at.
Well, no marriage is a perfect marriage,
right,
by the way.
But you weren't happy in this,
yes,
marriage.
Yes.
And so the opportunity comes to come to America.
Yes.
Come here and be a model. We've taken these photos of,
yes,
you. You're popular. Come with us.
Yeah.
You go because you're trying to get out of this marriage in some way.
In a way, also, yeah. First, trying to get out of the marriage. Secondly, trying to find what could happen. I've always been a firm believer that if you just take that road, what the outcome would be? Would it be
right.
so different? You know, like your whole life could be totally different. But one thing I've definitely insisted on before I left Africa was that I wanted, with all the contracts, everybody was saying, oh, I'll give you a contract. By the way, the contracts don't mean anything unless it's guaranteed.
Right.
And in modeling, there's nothing guaranteed. So what I asked for was a return ticket. Because the last thing I wanted is to be stuck in a foreign country, and I had no way back home. So I had that that return ticket.
Right.
So that was my way back. But it was a way to escape that and just see. And mind you, I was a girl who was never have been called beautiful. And now there's a world that thinks I'm beautiful. I'm going to go and explore it.
Yeah?
Yeah. And it's it was not it's not what I expected. It became something else.
When you first got here, were you surprised at the way both Africans and African Americans are treated in this country? I know you make a distinction about the two different groups, too,
yes,
the way they're treated.
Yes, because, you know, I found when I arrived here in 1975 that Americans have some kind of they give a carte blanche if you're a foreigner, rather than, especially blacks. If you are from the islands, a Caribbean descent or an African descent, it's different than an African American.
Mm-hmm.
The level of racism is different.
Yeah.
You know, we as Africans were given a little bit of a more of a leeway.
Yeah.
And obviously, the African American models at that time in 1975 felt it. And felt it quite rightly that why do they have to go to Africa to get a girl when we are here and we can't get a job? So the politics of it and the politics of beauty, the beauty industry, was not lost on me.
Yeah. How do you then deal with all of that going on around you? How is it that you work through that when you're pulled into a system like that?
Yes. Thank God I had some kind of understanding in terms of politics and how politics works, not in terms of just people think of when they think of politics, in terms of politics in the sense of government,
right,
of or governance. It's not that. There is politics. It could be the politics of beauty, the politics of ethics, the politics of even losing weight or not losing weight. There is a self-esteem, the politics of self-esteem. Politics have a lot of senses in that, that I had a quite understanding of it. And beside that, I was a child of the 60s, so I was quite aware of what was going on in this country, both good and bad. I was aware of it, of all its racism and all that, and I was also aware of all its good part from Martin Luther King to JF Kennedy Jr. So I knew, I was aware of all that. So I was aware of it is its good and bad side of it. But when I came here, I had to find my place from being called that I didn't look black enough, so I could not fit in that. Or I, because you know, I always laughed always about it. I say,
how much more black can I be?
But also, I am very Somali. The thing is, this the understanding of that when people say Africa is, it's still till today. People when they say talk about Africa, they talk about a whole continent, and they talk about like we're all one group of people. Like nobody says you are European.
Right.
They say you're Italian, you're French, you're English, you know, German. Nobody says you're just European. But in Africa, everybody just calls us all Africans, you know, like as if we are just one look fits all. And so, yeah, I mean, I might not look like a West African, but I look very East African. Yeah. You know, I come dime a dozen in my country. And I'm not something, you know, like, I hated the idea that he had a sense of being called that I looked like a white girl, but just browner. Yeah. I don't look like a white girl. I look Somali. I look an East African. I look a very Bantu tribe. You know, so that was my, and I'm trying to find my place, but in my own terms, because, you know, in my thinking, I don't have to belong to anybody. I know who I am and where I come from, and I don't have to say, the thing is this, I kept on saying, you know, I never considered myself a black woman. Because where I come from, we're all black.
Right, you're just a woman.
I didn't have to define myself by saying black. We're all black. So that was new to me, to be called by people that so-and-so black model. And I'm thinking, why did I need that definition?
Have you seen that change over the years?
Oh, no, absolutely not. There are people who still call me the black wife of David Bowie.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, I guess he had a white wife. I guess that's the description. No. I don't know.
Huh. After all these years?
Yeah. There are people who are set in their ways. But also, it's very, very clear. And I have to say the only way that they will describe us at times, unless you're really a known model, and Naomi Campbell, Tyra Banks, Iman, if they know you, then that's not tied on you. But if somebody would have described it, described somebody who doesn't know us, they would say, oh, yeah, Naomi Campbell, yeah. Well, that black famous model.
Right.
No, and at times, yes, it applies also to Giselle, the Brazilian model, but never to a Caucasian model. Nobody will say, to that white model. Cheryl Teakes, Christie Brinkley, that black white model.
Right.
They won't say that. You know?
How do you think, though, that affects, even today, young African-American, young girls of any color coming up, hearing things like that still?
I have always said, because in the business that I am, it's about photography and images. And I've always said photography is such an important an important tool, because the absence of images for young girls to see themselves celebrated, the absence of those images that look like them makes them feel not as good. They feel they're not considered beautiful. They're, what they look like is not beautiful. And the presence of it, of course, feels them validated. So when people say, well, what's in a picture? It's a lot's in a picture. Right. You know, if you are constantly bombarded with what is called the standard of beauty, which is blonde and blue-eyed, then that's what you want to be. Or you feel you're not part of that beauty, what's considered beautiful. So the whole thing about the ownership of beauty, the how to define beauty in your own standard and not wait for somebody else to tell you. How Salma Hayek properly put it in the foreword to my book, if beauty is in the eye of the beholder, then let the beholder be you, not somebody else.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you say then to your children? What do you say about these things? How do you instill in a child, in any child, to be proud of who you are in a world that bombards you? And it's not only with race, but with beauty.
Yes.
Because there are just a handful of the super beautiful in the world. The rest of us don't fit in there. So how do you let them know you're just as good?
The content. People have forgotten that beauty comes with content. You know, a vacuous beauty, it's an empty shell. It has no value. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I have known people who are very, very beautiful and quite ugly.
You know? Oh, so have I.
You know, and vice versa.
Yeah.
You know, so the people have forgotten about content, especially now what is celebrated. It's celebrated, fame and infamy has no difference now. Everybody is celebrated. You can be a star regardless whatever you have done. You could commit murder, you become a star.
Right.
You commit pornography, you're a star. You could do anything and you could become a star. So that is the stuff that we're teaching kids. And I have known, because we do internship at the office, and I have young girls who come in at the age of 15 and they want to be CEOs. What have you done?
Right.
You know, and they think everybody should become quite instantly very successful, because we see it in our society that the word is celebrated, especially in celebrity. It's quite fast. You can become so fast overnight as a star. Mm-hmm. And the kids don't understand what a star means. They don't care what it is. They just want to be a name.
Yeah.
You know?
When you hit and you got to America and all of this circus happened, do you ever wonder, because you say you'll go down other roads,
yeah.
Do you ever wonder if it had been a slower burn? If it had happened slower, the fame that came to you, would you have handled it any differently?
No, because you probably, in my situation, I probably would have been very frustrated and left the business quite fast. You know, I was like one of those, you know how when you see a duck swimming, you know, on a pond or something, it looks from the surface calm, but down at the it's paddling quite fast. I was like that. I was learning everything quite as fast as I could. And then there was the obstacles that were on the way that I knew that I had, that I was disposable to the business. As a black model, I was disposable. There was no really value that they placed on me. It was the politically correct thing to do. And so how do you create a self and a place for yourself in an industry that you are part of? Either you get out of it because you just get frustrated and you don't want to deal with it, or you find a way to make a really a value for yourself and what they think about you and all the people that will come behind you. Obviously, when you're doing that, you're not thinking about the people who are coming behind you. You're thinking about yourself and what is this about? And because they devalue you.
Right.
You know, especially as a black man, they devalue, because you always know that there is no, you have no value. This, we need to do this because it's the politically correct thing to do. Otherwise, it's really not important.
I would almost say, though, that there are models out there who don't realize that. That there are people in any walk of life that don't realize that they can be disposed of.
Yes.
And that's where a lot of danger comes, when people don't realize that. I mean, then they find themselves out there without a net.
Absolutely. And that, for me, that was my net. It's either I find a way to make this thing work for me so I feel that I am a person and I have a sense of value and that I am valued at what I'm doing. Otherwise, there's no reason for me to do this. I have to find something else to do. And hence, it started really from asking the price of services, because we weren't paid the amount of money that our counterparts were paid for the same services we were doing. So I learned quite fast to say no. I mean, I'll set it out, so no big deal. You know, you don't need me, I don't need you. Okay, fine, so everybody goes to their corners. And let's start it again, you know. And so, and I wanted what I called the spoils of war. Because in our industry, there's where you make money, and the rest of it is fluff. Mm-hmm. What you do in what's called editorial in the magazines, they pay you $250 a whole day. That's not money. There's prestige in it, but that's not money. Advertising, cosmetic contracts, that's where the money is. That's where they may pay you $500,000, $1 million for jobs. That's what I wanted. I wanted that spoils of war.
Yeah?
Yeah. And that's what I fought for.
Was it out of, and I don't mean this disrespectful, but was it out of greed or was it out of wanting to be valued?
It's about a value system. Okay. If you're going to pay that amount to another girl, why couldn't you pay me for the same service I provided? It's about that. It's about that. It's not about greed because if, you know, because at the sense, if it, usually people who are about greed, they will prostitute themselves. They'll do whatever it takes to get there. And my sense of value was that I'll sit it out. Either they'll come my way or no way.
But you also have to believe in yourself. Did you ever doubt yourself during all of that?
Never doubted myself. I doubted my looks, but I never doubted my services.
Did you ever think, well, am I good enough looking to be getting this money? Am I performing?
And if they come my way and pay me that money, I have to, deliver. Because at the end of the day, you have to sell.
Yeah.
If they use you in this major advertisement for that major money, the product has to move.
Does that drive you insane?
Well, that drives you insane because at the same time, because you won't get hired again.
Yeah.
For that. So you are as good as your last ad and how well it did.
I guess 89 or so is when you decided to walk away from modeling.
Yes.
And you did it cold.
Clean cut.
You weren't going to go back. It wasn't.
Nothing.
How did you come to that decision?
I'm the only one who has ever done it.
I know.
Apparently. And I was like, well, yes, at least I could claim that. I had enough money. I was made sure that I saved enough money so I won't be sucked in. Because it's a business that is so easy to make money at times. Mm-hmm. So I just made sure that I wanted a clean break, and there's no way to really find what you really want to do, what's your second act,
right?
Till you really stop. You can't be in between and not. I just wanted to be a calm, quiet place away from what I did before so I could think clearly of what's my next phase, what's my second act, what am I doing next.
Could someone entice you to come back today?
No, they have done it. They have tried.
Yeah.
They have tried. I have not even been to a fashion show since 89.
Really?
I'm a woman of my word.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Then, and I know we're running short on time, you went into the cosmetics business yourself because there was no successful or good line for women of color.
Yes.
How can that be possible?
That's very possible and still the same. In 1994, I created Iman Cosmetics, and the past year, as CEO of Iman Cosmetics, skincare and fragrances, I have been singularly the first and only brand who had a cosmetics for women, African Americans, Latina, Asian, multicultural, and multi-ethnic. I was the only brand who had an SPF in my products because they said women of color don't care about sun protection. So the creation, when I was writing 2 years ago, my beauty book, which I consider like a beauty tool because it's about techniques and tips and self-celebration of
the
all women with skin of color. Yeah. I wanted it really there to celebrate that, from the darkest of African beauty to a blonde, blue-eyed Brazilian model, Pakistani, Indians, everybody in between celebrated, and have young girls that are celebrated nowadays, from Ava Mendez, Naomi Campbell, Tyra Banks, Salma Hayek, in the book with their baby pictures, so that when young girls look at these books that they always are looking at in magazines, that they can say one day, I could be just like her when I grow up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you think that the reason that there wasn't a line of cosmetics for for women of color was because of prejudice? Because obviously they have the buying power out
Absolutely.
There. Why did it never happen?
It takes a lot of investment. It takes a lot of self-investment. It takes a lot of grassroots. It takes a lot of understanding what makes all these people different, what their specific needs are. The industry doesn't have that time. They're in it. It is about the bottom dollar. So what it is that, okay, if you have 5 shades or 6 shades or 8 shades for Caucasian women, put 2 more colors, make it darker, and you can claim it that it's for everybody. So they don't have to, and then they can spend a lot of money and have a celebrity endorse it, and they don't have to do anything on the product. But at the surface, look like they're doing for all women of all color.
Right. Last question. We're just about out of time, and I hate that it's gone so quick. A tip to people watching that people do wrong with their makeup.
I would say the singular one is that they always choose the wrong foundation for them. The perfect shade is a shade that looks like you. And the only way to test it is test it on your jawline. The color that you don't see, choose 2-3 colors. Put it on your jawline, strip them. The one you don't see is the perfect shade for you. That's your skin color.
There, a tip and everything. Iman, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us. Real quick, how's David doing?
David is doing fantastically well, fantastically well. He's home babysitting.
Oh, so he gets to watch the kid, you get to do the TV.
Exactly.
Iman, thank you very much.
Thank
a pleasure.
You.
Iman. To order a transcript, call 866-652-3378 or send $6.95 to the address on your screen. Please include the name of the guest.
All over the world today, people are gathered in love vigils to celebrate the life of a man that taught the world how to love. People may be wondering why there's such an emotional outburst, but you would have to understand the journey of Michael to understand what he meant to all of us. For these that sit here as the Jackson family, a mother and father with 9 children that rose from a working class family in Gary, Indiana. They had nothing but a dream. No one believed in those days that these kind of dreams could come true. But they kept on believing, and Michael never let the world turn him around from his dreams. I first met Michael around 1970, Black Expo, Chicago, Illinois, Reverend Jesse Jackson, who stood by this family till now. And from that day as a cute kid to this moment, he never gave up dreaming. It was that dream that changed culture all over the world. When Michael started, it was a different world. But because Michael kept going, because he didn't accept limitations, because he refused to let people decide his boundaries, he opened up the whole world. In the music world, he put on one glove, pulled his pants up, and broke down the color curtain where now our videos are shown and magazines put us on the cover. It was Michael Jackson that brought blacks and whites and Asians and Latinos together. It was Michael Jackson that made us sing We Are the World and Feed the Hungry long before Live Aid. Because Michael Jackson kept going, he created a comfort level where people that felt they were separate became interconnected with his music. And it was that comfort level that kids from Japan and Ghana and France and Iowa and Pennsylvania got comfortable enough with each other to later it wasn't strange to us to watch Oprah on television. It wasn't strange to watch Tiger Woods golf. Those young kids grew up from being teenage, comfortable fans of Michael to being 40 years old and being comfortable to vote for a person of color to be the president of the United States of America. Michael did that. Michael made us love each other. Michael taught us to stand with each other. There are those that like to dig around mess, but millions around the world, we're going to uphold his message. It's not about mess, it's about his love message. As you climb up steep mountains, sometimes you scar your knee. Sometimes you break your skin, but don't focus on the scars. Focus on the journey. Michael Beter, Michael rose to the top. He outsang his cynics. He outdanced his doubters. He outperformed the pessimists. Every time he got knocked down, he got back up. Every time you counted him out, he came back in. Michael never stopped. Michael never stopped. Michael never stopped. I want to say to Mrs. Jackson and Joe Jackson, his sisters and brothers, we thank you for giving us someone that taught us love, someone that taught us hope. We want to thank you because we know it was your dream too. And we know that your heart is broken. I know you have some comfort from the letter from the President of the United States and Nelson Mandela, but this was your child. This was your brother. This was your cousin. Nothing will fill your heart's loss. But I hope the love that people are showing will make you know he didn't live in vain. And I want his three children to know, wasn't nothing strange about your daddy. It was strange what your daddy had to deal with. But he dealt with it. He dealt with it anyway. He dealt with it for us. So some came today, Mrs. Jackson, to say goodbye to Michael. I came to say thank you. Thank you because you never stopped. Thank you because you never gave up. Thank you because you never gave out. Thank you because you tore down our divisions. Thank you because you eradicated barriers. Thank you because you gave us hope. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael.
Very strong, independent person. She's got her own business and she knows what she wants. She also looks after other women in parenthood centers. So she's quite into the environment of helping other people, not just making money from her flower shop and being selfish.
I
In terms of being a florist, I had my own florist in New York just teach me how to cut flowers and do basic stuff. And, I mean, it's just preparing myself for being a best friend to someone. I'm very close to the friends that I have, and Kate Moss and Chrissy Hinton are my really close friends. And so it's just like being in any type of day-to-day situation. If your girlfriend really needs your help, you know, are you going to be there? And I am there for Kate and Christy, whatever.
Are you living your dream?
I'm living my life day by day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for your time.
It's a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you. Tony, it's just a reverse for when.
I like older men. I like men that like men, rugged men. I've not been married yet. And I've only been in love once. I'm not a virgin at any means. I'm not going to sit here and say I'm a virgin, even though I'm dressed in white. I mean, no. I do feel now that it's, you know, you have to pick the person, whoever you're companioning, more carefully. I mean, safe sex is definitely important. And I think that, you know, women, well, for me right now, I'm going through this phase of, you have to, like, treat yourself a bit more special in that respect. Like, don't just jump in the bed with someone, you know? Even if you're dying to, I think. What's more important is sex is not going to be the topic of your relationship. You've got to have companionship, you've got to have conversation, you know, you've got to have things in life that's just other than sex. I mean, I love sex, but...
The press has married you with a lot of people.
The press marry me with a fucking chicken if they could. But that's okay. I don't mind. I laugh about it now.
Yes, but the press has married you with Robert De Niro, Mike Tyson. What's the truth?
I've only been in love once, and my only love was Robert De Niro. And we're friends still, we're very good friends. And he's extremely proud of me now that I am acting.
Do you dream of a very normal life with an husband, 3 or 4 children?
I'm not a normal person, so I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. I know that I'm very hyper-energetic, and I always know in my life I'm always going to be traveling. I do enjoy traveling. And I've always said whenever I do have a child, that poor child is going to be traveling all over the world. It's going to be not going to know what jet lag is because, I mean, I traveled all over the world as a child, and so I don't see why my child can't do that. When it comes for time for having it be settling down, and that'll be a different matter. But, yeah, I guess I do want the girl next door dream of getting married and having a husband and a nice little house and kids, but not right now. Just like fairy tale, or it's a real world, and there's always hope, and everyone should never diminish their hope. It's something that's important to have and to keep striving towards achieving.
Thank you.
Thank you. Slash, you're amazing. You're awesome. Thank you. Listen. Thank you. I love you. Some of us like to play it safe and take each day as it comes. Some of us like to take that crazy walk on the wild side. So, for those of us who like living dangerously, this one's for you. She came into the place I knew had been in there. There was something different about this girl. The way she moved, her hair, her face, her lines, divinity in motion. When she stepped in the room, I could feel the air of her presence. Every hit, she lost. The girl was possessed. The girl was twisted. The girl was bad.
Dangerous.
Michael Jackson's going to make money off of his name, or someone's going to make money off of his name for the rest of time.
Yeah, you know, Elvis, with Elvis Presley as our guide, there's a lot of money to be made posthumously. They are very good business people within the Elvis Presley grouping. I just wonder, I guess, is it Randy Jackson would take over something like this? Because they all seem to be fighting for the money.
Well, exactly. I mean, it kind of depends who this, you know, who is in charge of the will. Right now, it's his two past business associates,
right.
But, you know, his mother has control of 40% of his estate. But you have to remember, there's still those three kids that need to make sure that they're taken for. And if he did leave them some of his unpublished songs, that will help them along. But all in all, I'm sure their upbringing is going to be very hard. They lost their father, and their father was Michael Jackson.
Yeah, Ashlyn Gorse from E! News and on E! Entertainment Television. Good to talk to you. Thanks for coming by. Adam Housley's out there in front of this whole thing. Adam, it looks like they're in the Staples parking lot now.
Yeah, Shepard, they've just arrived on the other side. We're being told that a certain area, in fact, an area where Greta Van Susteren has been reporting from, has been shut down, and the family will be coming in through that way, we're told. So we await that information. I'll give you a live look, too. The last part of the people arriving, Shepard, are starting to go inside. As Los Angeles goes, as you know, people like to arrive late, and that's the case here, as the ceremony is going to start late, and the people are still coming and doing it in a very orderly fashion. We're told now by the LAPD that they have more than 1,800 officers in this area. Roughly around 2,000, I'm told, is the actual number. They say 1,800 officially. We also have been told there have been no major problems outside this two-block area around Staples Center that's been cordoned off for the last 24 hours or so to keep people away unless you have a ticket. Not nearly as many people showed up as they expected, partly, they believe, because people wanted to be able to see this on television. We're also told that when Michael Jackson's casket arrives here, one reason why it was somewhat downplayed by LAPD, even though the AP said that they were the ones that confirmed it, was because they didn't want people to try to come here and maybe dote over the hearse as it drove in. So that's what's taking place right here outside Shepherd right now. As you can see, people coming in. There's a massive police presence. It's been here all morning. People have stopped. And in fact, we can show the panels over here real quick, Scotty. There's these large panels. There's eight of them. And people have been signing their names and leaving their remembrances of Michael Jackson all over them all morning. They're almost full now, all the way up to the top. And they're about 8 to 9 feet high and about, looks like, 12 feet or so long, massive panels that have been signed from those going inside, Shepherd, people taking pictures, and there's been a ton of flowers arriving here as well as people head inside to pay their remembrances to Michael Jackson. We're told also originally scheduled for 1 hour, then up to 90 minutes. Now we're told don't be surprised if it goes longer than that. And the people running this show, you just heard from your last guest, the same people that do a lot of the award shows here, we know them from covering those award shows, Shepherd. They're used to having those award shows go long, so if this does go longer than 90 minutes, as now expected, there are people that can definitely roll with the punches and make that happen. Shepard?
Adam, thanks. Now crossing on city wires, state wires, national urgent wires, Associated Press flash alert wires, seven lines on the screen in front of me, Dateline Los Angeles, Associated Press, --, Michael Jackson's golden casket arrives at Staples Center ahead of public memorial, and now flashing is the 16th lead right through on the Michael Jackson story for today. In other words, the 16th version of this story has just been sent out to the world by Associated Press. And of that, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 copies, 16 different versions of the 16th lead right through from Associated Press. Michael Jackson's golden casket has arrived at Staples Center in downtown Los Angeles for a public memorial service. A hearse carried the flower-draped casket in a motorcade from a private service earlier today at a ceremony hall in the Hollywood Hills. A law enforcement escort shut down large sections of the freeways to speed the motorcade through Los Angeles traffic. So at 9 minutes before, what, 10 o'clock in the morning, the attendees are gathering. I was going to say mourners, but there's nothing to say that all these people are mourning, and certainly I would guess that a lot of people are treating this as what it will be if it all comes off, and that is one hell of a concert. I mean, think of who is going to be performing today, and if you had to pay for a ticket to such an event, what it would cost you. Adam Housley.
We are going to see the king. We are
Campbell, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Carlos.
You got into modeling at 15, is that right?
I was discovered at 14, did my first job at 15 mm-hmm. and a half.
Did you know you were going to be a hit? You were going to have all the success that you've had?
No.
Naomi credits Christy Turlington with helping her achieve supermodel status. But though she's often grouped with Revlon girl Cindy Crawford, guest spokesmodel Claudia Schiffer, and Calvin Klein icon Kate Moss, the same high-paying contracts had never gone to Naomi. Did you ever look out at some of the opportunities they were having and say, I should be having that
Many too? Many times, but my mother had always told me not to compare because that I would have to work 150 times harder than a Caucasian person, so I've always been aware of that.
Beth Ann Hardison became one of the first black supermodels in the 1960s. Now one of the biggest managers in the business, Hardison launched the careers of models like Calvin Klein's Tyson Beckford and most notably, Naomi Campbell.
When she had a problem with her agency, she would go up against the agency, she'd go up against the client. She fought for herself. If she found out her counterpart model, another model, was getting a different salary than her, she went up against them. A lot of models wouldn't do that.
I didn't become one of the Revlon girls because I wouldn't accept a low fee.
They offered it to you.
And I said no.
Any regrets?
No.
What are you fearful of? Go ahead.
Well, I think I'm fearful of addiction always.
You said you didn't begin heavily using drugs until you were in your mid-20s.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So all those years in your teens when you're traveling around the world, a young jet setter, not at all or just not regularly?
No, not at all.
So why go 8, 9, 10 years and then all of a sudden start using?
I don't know. I can't answer that question. Why use at all? You know, what are we, you know, I definitely had a lot of things that I didn't want to face. I definitely had a lot of things I wanted to cover. And, you know, and...
Love, relationships?
More grief, people that I loved who died. And you never start out doing drugs, I think, to cover. You start out as recreational for fun, and then it does, I can assure you, take over. Alcohol too, it does take over.
So what finally made you ready to admit it?
I just was spiritually broken, and I was on a job, actually a job for my, that was for my perfume, and I was just I was just a bag of bones and no good. And I was just in a really bad place.
As if battling addiction wasn't enough, journalist Piers Morgan took it upon himself to splash Naomi's struggle with drugs all over the pages of London's Daily Mirror. You were coming out of a Narcotics Anonymous meeting, and he put that in the newspaper.
As something I should be ashamed of, and I'm not ashamed of it. I think recovery is the healthiest form to be in.
Are you fully in recovery now?
I'm fully in recovery.
First time we've ever met. And I meet you, and as nice as the day is long, and I see the big heart, and I hear it, and I read about it. And obviously, I've also read about some of the things that have happened in terms of violence and anger. How do those go together, the generous spirit and...
I'm human. As I said, I make mistakes. I admit them. And I try to learn from them. I'm always remorseful for whatever wrong I've done. But lack of sleep, lack of eating, right? All these things do make up a person and how they are, they come across in their mood or, and I've had to like look at all of those things and it's simple things.
Throwing the phones, the scratching, all of that you think of as at least in part tied to basic human issues, being tired, being hungry.
Well, because I've never ever spoken ever my side of why, and I never will. I'm wrong because I'm the bigger person. I shouldn't do that, and I accept that.
What do you mean when you say that?
Because I'm the person that's known, so I shouldn't do that. Mm-hmm. Because no matter what, being in the public eye, you're wrong.
In a very real kind of human way, what has happened? What is behind
it? When people like steal or take things from you or do things to hurt you, you know, it's very hard because people say, oh, but why would you care? You got so much. But that's not the point. It's the principle.
You've literally called people red-handed stealing from you.
I'm not going to answer that.
When you look at the modeling industry today, and obviously you hear a lot of criticism about girls taking things and trying to remain thin, do you think there's going to be any real change in that, or do you think it's always been that way and it's always going to be that way?
I mean, it's a different generation of girls. I really don't know.
Interesting.
But I don't like skinny women. I don't.
Why? You're a skinny woman.
I'm not skinny.
No?
I don't think, I wouldn't call myself skinny.
What would you call yourself?
Just a regular size.
There's a rumor that you've got a very special walk that you might be willing to teach me.
You have to stop. Like when you come on from here, you have to walk on very strong.
Okay.
Then walk.
Okay.
But when you get there, you're strong and confident.
Okay.
Or you're confident. No way.
No.
Go back.
Oh, okay. I'm not
Do
falling.
Again.
I'm not going to get too excited.
Back.
Okay. What you're saying, have the shoulders back or not?
Shoulders a little back. Like that. I have a jacket for 10.
People have all these preconceptions about you or about anyone in the public eye. If you could say one thing that you haven't said to kind of set the record straight, what would you say?
You can't judge a book by its cover. And I think you have to open the book and look inside.